Welcome to the online classroom of SRKRMA. Today we have scheduled the session for MCOM students this semester, and the topic is basic concepts in Web Module 1. To handle this session, we have with us Dr. Anjini Dev R, Assistant Professor of Commerce, Government College for Women, Trivandrum. She has taken her PhD in Marketing Strategies adopted by Tourism Industry in South India, comparative to Delhi, Kerala, and Tamil Nadu. I would also like to mention the first time holder in MCOM from Kerala University. Thank you, and over to you, ma'am.
Actually, we have seen about risk management. Actually, today we are going to see the basic concepts in risk. This is the module 1 for risk management and derivatives. So, we are dealing with the basic concepts in risk in the sense. We'll be seeing about what is risk, what are the different types of risk, and what are the different categorization of risk, and how risk is affecting the life of a person. And not only that, we'll be also seeing how the different types of risk can be handled, or what are the different methods to handle the risk, and also what is actually the burden of risk on the society, and how this risk can be used in financial analysis, that is covered under this module. So to start with, the first thing that we are going to see is about risk. We all know what is actually risk. Whenever we come across a different situation or a difficult situation in our life, we say that it is a risky situation. Why? Because we always have uncertainties in our life. And we are always concerned about the uncertainties in our day-to-day life, and that is actually risk, which we cannot predict in advance what will be the risk, but at least we can estimate that this will be the risk in the future. So risk is actually something which is related to uncertainties, which may be connected with the occurrence of an event. Risk can be objective or subjective. We always hear about these two terms, objectivity as well as subjectivity. What does this clearly mean? Objective in the sense, you always expect something to happen, but the actual thing that happen in your life will be totally different. Maybe you expect that nothing will happen to you in life. Maybe without your expectation, or maybe beyond your expectation, you may be suffering from a serious illness, which you will be later on identifying. That is actually a variation in the actual loss from that of the expected loss. If you quantify it also, it can be treated as an objective risk. Whenever we want to calculate the statistical measure that is used for objective risk calculation is standard deviation, because we know that standard deviation measures the difference. What is actually the deviation from the average? What is actually the expected return? What is the deviation from the expected return? That is measured with the help of standard deviation. And a relative measure that we make use is what is called as coefficient of variation, which actually shows a relationship between standard deviation and mean. So this can be, objective risk can be calculated with the help of standard deviation or coefficient of variation. So that is with regard to objective risk. Next, risk is actually subjective risk. Why subjective? Because it is based on the mental condition, or you can say the state of mind of a person. How people behave, you cannot predict, because the behavior of people differ from each and every individual. Each and every person is considered as different, and therefore how they perceive a risky situation in their life, how they overcome the risky situation in their life, it's totally different. So it depends on the individual. That is why it is called as a subjective risk, because it is subject to an individual. So that is, risk can be broader, in broader terms, this can be objective risk as well as subjective risk. But
we have more classifications because the basic type of risk includes something more than this. That is, first one is pure and speculative risk. The second one is fundamental and particular risk. And the last one is enterprise risk. Pure as well as speculative risk. Let us see one by one the different types of risk. You can see the picture of a father and a daughter, maybe at the grave of their dear one. So from the picture itself, you can identify it is a person is very much young. So maybe his wife expired. So it is a case of premature death. Then another case is which we always expect because of the in the era of gas leakages in houses, we always expect a type of a fire breakthrough, breakout in our house, so which can be covered with the help of fire insurance. How this is related? Because this is purely related to pure risk. So pure risk is actually a situation where there is a possibility of either loss or no loss. Because we fear there will be a gas leakage, but never that happens, then we are very safe and secure. So that is actually a pure risk, which can be concerned with loss or no loss situation. So that is the examples that we have seen, maybe due to the already said examples, or it can be job related activities also. Because you have done something, you have a punishment, or maybe you are suspended. So that is actually a pure risk situation where you are incurring a loss, maybe incurring a loss in the form of losing the income for a particular time. Next, you can see here that there are two options for the person. What are the options? Either a risk or a reward. And that is actually the essence of speculative risk. Because you know, you are very much familiar with speculation as a term. Because here you are not planning it. You want to make a profit whenever it is possible. So it is either profit or it can be a loss. So either a risk or a reward. But there can be three outcomes out of this. That is, as we have seen, profit, that means reward. Something good may happen. Then it can be a risk. That means it can be a loss, that is something bad can happen, or nothing can happen, it will remain the same. That is what we are normally expecting. Now this type of risk is not insurable, but it can be reduced. Because what is the aim of the person? Because the aim of the person is to make maximum profit. So if you want to make maximum profit, you will have to take the risk. And if you want to take the risk, you can opt for derivatives, where you can hedge the risk or you can diversify your investment by investing in different types of funds at the same time. So that is actually a speculative risk. So we have seen the first classification, that is pure risk and speculative risk. The second classification, before seeing the classification, look at the first one. What does this indicate? This indicates what? Something is going on an increase. Now this is actually referring to the increase in prices, which we normally call as inflation. Another situation where which we do not want to happen in our country, which is a case of a war. Another situation where we are normally experiencing is earthquake in our country. These are examples of a type of risk which we call as fundamental risk. So what is actually fundamental risk? It is a risk which is affecting the entire economy. It is affecting huge numbers which we are unable to control. What is now happening? That is, in the case of COVID-19, so many people are being affected. We cannot actually find out or measure the risk because it is the entire economy or large numbers being affected. So it can be caused by a natural phenomenon which we have seen in the form of earthquake or tsunami or any type of a flood. The economic crisis that happens in different countries affecting nations, the impact of political decisions, which can create a type of fundamental risk. Then the next one is particular risk. As the name indicates, particular risk can be in the form of a job loss, a person losing his job suddenly, or a personal property being destroyed. It is due to maybe man-made or maybe due to nature, whatever it may be, there is a destruction to the property. So what is actually a particular risk? It is a risk that is affecting an individual. It is not affecting the entire community, but it is affecting a particular person, and it may be due to specific events. Because you are not performing well in the organization, you may be thrown out. You are not driving properly on the road, that is the reason for the accident. So that is a particular risk. So we have seen two classifications: pure and speculative risk, fundamental and particular risk. The next classification is enterprise risk. So what is enterprise? What do you mean by the term enterprise? Something which is connected to the organization. And enterprise risk means all the risk which is faced by the organization, by the business firm. It can include the above mentioned risk, every type of risk, that is pure risk, it can be speculative risk, whatever risk may be. But the main content of enterprise risk is strategic, operational and financial risk. When we say strategic risk, strategy is actually a term which is always used by a company or an organization in order to face competition from the competing firms. That is normally a used term. So strategic risk is always connected with uncertainty regarding whether the company's goals can be achieved or not. Why these goals cannot be achieved? Maybe because of an unsuccessful business plan, and that can be corrected by a proper strategy. But if you are not able to achieve the as per the business plan, that can be treated as a strategic risk. Then another risk is, before seeing that, there are different types of strategic risk. Maybe this is not very important as per the module, but anyway, cover these types of strategic risk like governance, operational, competitive, financial and reputational. This is actually adopted by a company or a consulting group, a consultancy group, in order to identify what are the different types of strategic risks that they have identified. The next type of risk is operational risk. Operational risk is actually the risk from the business operations. That means daily, when a business carries out its operations, what is this type of risk that they will have to face? So the basic type of risk that they will have to face is maybe non-availability of raw materials, the problem that is created by workers in the organization, or maybe due to some other factors which cannot be controlled. So that is operational risk. And operational risk, that means it stems out from different areas. It may be from the people, it may be from the process as such in the organization, it may be from different systems which is operating within the environment or which is external to the environment, that is external events. So all these encompasses the operational risk. So we have seen strategic risk, operational risk covering under enterprise risk. This actually shows the picture of different commodities, gold, currency, etc. This indicates interest rates, which may be falling, the exchange rates. All these three indicate financial risk. What is actually financial risk? Financial risk is actually the uncertainty which is caused due to the changes in exchange rate, changes in commodity prices, changes in the interest rates. So it can be due to the interest, commodity, foreign exchange. So all these can be treated as a market risk that is created, which you have already learned in security analysis and portfolio management, where there are two types of risk, systematic risk and unsystematic risk, and where you have seen about market risk. So these three contribute towards market risk, which is actually financial risk. But financial risk is also influenced by the cash flows, the liquidity, the financing, the external source of financing, the counterparties who are involved, the partners who are involved in it, the credit period that is allowed, the parties who are involved. All these are interconnected, and that is actually seriously affecting the financial risk. So we have seen about the basic types of risk. Which are the basic types of risk? Pure and speculative risk, fundamental and particular risk, and enterprise risk. So when you classify enterprise risk, it consists of three. One is strategic, the other one is operational, and the last one is, as you have seen, the last one is financial risk. Next, we have seen the first one as pure and speculative risk. So what are the different types of pure risk? Pure risk means, which you have already seen, the risk that is can be incurring a loss. So it can be in three ways. One is in personal way, it is affecting the property, or it can be creating a liability. So how this personal risk is affecting? Because it is directly affecting an individual, and there can be different types of ways in which an individual may be affected by this type of risk, which we have already seen in risk of premature death. Then maybe a person retires from service, he is not finding it sufficient maybe to carry on his livelihood. So there is a loss of income that is caused. Then another risk can be due to poor health after retirement. He is subject to some type of an illness, so he'll have to pay more for his medical bills. Then there is always a risk of unemployment also. When a person is losing his income, that is actually a risk that is created, which is in the form of personal risk. So the options can be in the form of retiring people can go for any pension fund or pension plan, so that they will not be facing that much amount of risk. So that is personal risk. The next one is property risk. There is always a risk that the property will be damaged. And whenever you think about damage of property, there are two types of loss. They are direct loss and consequential loss. Direct loss means the loss that is directly resulting from the damage. Sudden earthquake, gas leakage, fire, these are all direct losses. What is the indirect loss? Suppose earthquake occurs, how can we rebuild? As we have seen in Kerala flood, there were so many districts affected. How they decided to, or people came back to their homes, they had to spend a lot, and they will have to bring back all their houses into the old position. So that is actually a property risk that is faced. It can be a direct loss and the consequential loss. Then the next risk is what is called as liability risk. So what is actually liability risk? From this picture itself, you may be getting an idea what will be liability risk. You are creating a type of an injury to some other person. Maybe you may be held responsible. So it is actually a legal liability for any act which you commit, which is causing an injury to a person. If you are causing an injury to a person, that can be treated as a legal liability risk, and the liability will be in the form of normally when you are a customer, you are buying something and you later on find out that this is not up to the mark. If there is a process of where there is a provision for exchange, then you can go for exchange or otherwise claim for the liability for any damage resulting from the purchase or maybe use of a commodity. Suppose if you are making use of a face screen and something happens to your face, then you can claim or you can legally approach it, and that type of risk is actually a legal liability risk. So from what we have seen till now, there are different types of pure risk. What are the different types of pure risk? It is personal risk, property risk, and liability risk. Actually, liability risk is the legal liability risk. Then, we have now seen the different types of pure risk. Now, we are going to see about the different types of financial risk. Because we have already seen in the classification of enterprise risk, there are actually three types of enterprise risk: strategic risk, operational risk, and financial risk. So what are the different types of financial risk? Financial risk can be classified into three, that is interest rate risk, commodity price risk, and currency exchange risk. What is interest rate risk? Any change in the or any loss that may arise due to the fluctuation in the interest rate. This you have learned earlier itself in security analysis and portfolio management. In valuation of bonds, a company will be issuing bonds whenever the interest rates are very high. If they want to sell the bond, what they will do is the coupon rate should be equal to the required rate of return. Required rate of return is what you have learned as yield to maturity, YTM. So coupon rate is actually the rate of interest on the bonds. So if the interest rate declines, then the company will have to pay higher coupon rates, and that is actually the bond pricing theorems that you have learned. There is an inverse relationship. So that is interest rate risk. Then another risk of financial nature is commodity prices. See, whenever there is a change in the prices of commodities, as you have recently experienced, due to lockdown, we may not be able to go out and buy our provisions or maybe vegetables, and we will have to opt for online purchase. In some cases, we expect or we face what you call as a payment of a service charge or maybe a delivery charge or something like that, which is actually adding to our expenses, which is a commodity price risk. Because of the changes in the price, the price of the commodity is already changing, and in addition to that, you are also experiencing an extra payment to be made. So it is actually affecting two categories or two persons. One is the consumers, and the other category is the producers. For the consumers, the serious effect is on the family budget. The family budget goes upside down. They will be there, whatever they are keeping as reserve, the reserves are to be used. So that is seriously affecting the consumers. But if you look at the producers, it is in the other way around. When there is a fall in prices, as you have seen now, the restaurants are closed. So what the only way for the restaurants is to have the online delivery of food. It was already there, but now it is materializing because this is the apt time for which where you can capitalize on these online delivery mechanisms. But for the producers, because of the fall in the what you call as a rush of the consumers to the restaurants, there is a reduction in the profit and they are incurring the losses. So So that is also a commodity price risk, which is coming under financial risk. Next, this can be seen with the case of an example also. You can consider a cereal company which has agreed to deliver a cereal, a pulse, maybe a green gram, at agreed price. But suppose if the price of it changes, then the profitability for the whole transaction, it gets affected. And the best way is to have a commodity derivative. Go for a commodity derivative, in the sense you can tide over the risk. Okay. Another type of financial risk is currency exchange risk. That is, what is the value for which one currency can be converted for or to another currency. So this normally we see. We normally see that the most preferred currency, or the currency which is having the maximum value, is US dollar. And US dollar becomes strong when something happens, that when a foreign currency, that suppose it's the Indian rupee, is you will have to pay a lot more in order to buy US dollars. So US dollar becomes strong. So the loss of value that is caused due to the exchange of one currency into another, that is the currency exchange risk. So we are seeing actually the different types of financial risk. As we have seen till now, it is the different types of financial risk include interest rate risk, commodity price risk, and currency exchange risk. Next, what is actually the burden of risk created on the society? So we were actually seeing till now what is risk, what are the different types of risk, and in the classification itself, what are the sub-classifications of risk. What is actually the impact of risk on the society? That is what we are going to see next. The impact that is created by risk on society is in three ways. One is larger emergency fund. Second one is loss of some goods and services. And the third one is worry and fear. So what is actually the three types of burden? That is what we are going to see in detail. The first one is larger emergency fund. Why larger emergency fund? Because suddenly you are affected by some type of an event or some type of a situation that is a risky situation. So you have to face it. So the best thing is you will have to make keep aside a certain portion as reserve, because you want to meet for the future, because this is a risk that may arise. So your earmarking funds. So when you earmark funds, the first thing you will have to do is you will have to compromise now. And that is the essence of large emergency fund. Means the size of the emergency fund, if you are going to increase, then that can be done only by compromising with the consumption now. You are not consuming now. If you look at the household expense, you can cut short the household expenses and you can maintain a reserve for the future. So that is larger emergency fund. Then, another burden that is created on the society is the loss of certain goods and services. See, companies, they always fear the type of product that they manufacture. If it is not up to the quality, they may withdraw the product from the market. For example, childhood vaccines. We heard an issue regarding the vaccinations given. Some of the vaccines are not being used, or it is banned in different countries, so it shall not be used. So if such type of a news comes in, immediately there is a withdrawal of vaccines. Then similarly, birth control devices, if it is not of that much quality, or maybe artificial limb manufacturing organizations, these are all, it is actually a loss, a sudden loss that is created because the consumers are not getting the goods and services. As you have seen in the lockdown situation, where people, differently abled people and old age people suffered a lot because they are not getting the medicines, they are not able to get the proper medicines or proper medical care because of this situation. So there is a risk, and that risk is creating a burden on the society. And the last one is worry and fear, which we normally have, because we have different state of mind, and we have a mental unrest, and we always fear. And nowadays we always fear whether we are having, even if we are having a small cough or something like that, we always fear that it's something serious. Why? Because of the situation, we are having that state of mind. So that is worry and fear. So what is actually the burden of risk that is created on the society? It is, you will have to create more funds, that is larger emergency fund. Another one is there is a loss of certain goods and services. Some of the goods may be withdrawn from the market, and there will be worry and fear in the minds of the people. So that is the burden of risk on the society. Next, how you can handle the risk? What are the different methods in which you can handle the risk? There are different methods to handle the risk. One of the methods is to avoid the risk. Now, how you can avoid the risk? You can avoid the risk by taking sufficient precautions. Make maximum safety or take maximum safeguards in order to avoid the risk to happen. That is one of the methods, which may not be possible in all the situations, but in some cases it may be possible also. Then, second one is loss control. Yesterday we have seen about risk control, where we are concerned about the frequency and the severity of the risk or losses. So, loss control is actually a method where we can reduce both frequency as well as severity of the loss. There are mainly two objectives for loss control. One is either to prevent the loss from occurring or to reduce the loss. So to prevent the loss means, how can you prevent the loss? Is you can reduce the frequency. Suppose you know that if you do something, this will happen. So no need to do it. So that is actually you are reducing the frequency. Then loss reduction means you are reducing the severity of the loss. And that is done with the help of taking insurance. Because you don't want to, maybe if you are having an accident compensation insurance, you don't want to lose that much, because you will be getting a compensation, or maybe you will be getting an amount. So that is, you're reducing the loss. So these are the two objectives behind loss control. That is either to prevent the loss or to reduce the loss. So we are actually seeing the methods of handling this. The first method is to avoid it. The second one is to control it, control the loss. The next one is to retain the loss. The retain the risk means either a part of the risk or whole of the risk. See, there are two types of retention. It can be active retention or passive retention. Active retention, as the name indicates, the person who retains the risk is fully aware of the consequence, and he is planning that he want to retain the risk. So what he want to do is, he don't want to invest in insurance, he don't want to take insurance, he just want to save the money. But what will happen, he cannot predict, but that is actually active retention of the risk. The second one is passive retention. Passive retention means it is purely because of ignorance, because you don't know. You don't know what will happen. You are unaware of it, or maybe you are lazy. You are not at all bothered. You are indifferent towards it. That is passive retention. But that is considered as dangerous, because if the retained risk is affecting the financial budgets, then it should be taken very seriously. So retention can be active retention, or it can be a passive retention. So we have seen one of the method of risk handling, that is avoiding. The second one is loss control. The next one is retention. The next one is non-insurance transfers. The name indicates that it is not covering or it is not something related to insurance, because you are not transferring it to an insurance company, but it is transferred to some other party, and it is done by means of a contract. Suppose if you are buying a television, or maybe if you are buying a laptop, you can have a service contract. You can have an extended warranty where you will be transferring the risk. If something happens, then you will be transferring the risk. It is not transferred to an insurance company. That is why it is a non-insurance transfer. So it is a transfer of risk by contract. Another non-insurance transfer is hedging. Because you know that the prices will fluctuate, you can buy or sell using these derivative contracts or future contracts can be opted for hedging the price risk. Another option is incorporation of the business firm. That is, you simply state that the personal property cannot be attached. That is, our liability is limited for any payment of debt. It will not be held responsible. So there are actually three forms of non-insurance transfers. That is, the first one is transfer of risk by contract, hedging prices, and incorporation of a business firm. Actually, we are seeing the methods of handling this, and we are seeing non-insurance transfer. The next one will be insurance transfer. This is actually a practical method of handling this, where you are transferring your risk to another person. The another person here indicates the insurance company or the insurer. So you are assigning your risk to a third party with the help of an agreement. It can be in three forms. It is in the form of taking an insurance, or it can be in the form of having a derivative agreement, or it can be in the form of outsourcing. You are transferring your risk to some other person. So that is what is called as risk transfer. Another technique is pooling technique, where you know that somebody will be having a disease or something like that. Everyone agrees to take an insurance against that particular disease or that particular epidemic. So that is actually a pooling technique in risk. That is, group of companies, small companies, they join together in order to get a better insurance rate. That means they want to spread the risk among different persons, so that the burden of risk can be reduced. So the first one that we have seen under insurance is risk transfer. The second one that we have seen right now is pooling technique. This is the example of a pooling technique in business terms, where you join together and you market as such, so there is a change. Then another technique is law of large numbers. Actually, this is applicable as a mathematical technique, which states that if you increase the number of cases, the result will be accurate. It is actually like this. In research, it is always said that when you include more number of samples, the result will be more accurate. So it is actually concerned with greater accuracy. That means including more and more numbers. It is like acting as a group. So the difference between the estimated future loss and the actual loss, that is what is called as a risk, that becomes very less. So that is a case of law of large numbers, which comes under insurance. So we have seen about the different types of the different methods of handling risk. Now, moving on to the last part, what is actually financial analysis in risk management decision making? Yesterday we have seen risk management in detail, but this is actually concerned about how you have a financial analysis in risk management. Whenever you make investments, you are concerned about the time value of money, because the money that you invest today will be having a value more than the money that you invest the next day. So the time value of money is considered. Then similarly, different time period risk management decisions will be influencing the cash flows. Then the interest earning capacity. If you are investing the cash flows, what is actually the earning capacity? How much income that you can earn? So this is actually the financial analysis part in risk management decision making, which comes as a small part in your module. What is actually the applications of financial analysis, especially when you have seen these different types of risks? The first one is analyzing insurance coverage bids. That means what is the type of insurance that is being offered? What will be the number of loss, or what will be the size of loss? You make a comparison between how much insurance you have taken and what will be the loss that you are expecting. And another one is loss control investment decision. That means you try to reduce the frequency, the severity of the losses. And how can you reduce the frequency and severity, which we have already seen? It can be reduced or can be analyzed. In financial analysis, we make it with the help of capital budget. So this is actually regarding the financial analysis applications of risk. So we have seen the basic concepts of risk in detail with the help of this module. With this, I come to the end of the this module 1. Thank you.
First question is from Vidya ji. Her question is, how to manage external risk of an organization?
External risk. If a company is having an external risk, what the company can do is, maybe from the previous experience, the companies know that the external risk can be in the form of maybe a complaint raised by the people who are residing nearby the company, which because of pollution or something like that, that they can take as a precaution. What they can do is they can install or they can provide devices where it is not polluting the environment. That is the way in which they can deal with such type of external issue. This is one of the example of an external issue.
Okay, ma'am. Next question is from VK. Can you please explain the difference between chance of a loss and risk?
Okay. The risk is actually a situation where you cannot predict. So, predict in the sense, risk is actually an uncertainty situation. So, an uncertainty situation means it is a chance. It is a chance that there can be a risk, or there can be a loss, or there may not be a loss. So that is, it is purely out of chance, and risk is out of chance. It can be uncertain. It can be towards a certain extent. In some cases, it can be certain. So actually, chance of loss is inherent in risk.
Thank you, ma'am. Next question, we don't have a name, the question is, avoidance is considered as an effective risk control technique, but is it possible or practical for a firm to avoid all potential loss?
In the case of a company, it may not be possible, but in the case of a person, it is definitely possible, because you have a risk, maybe after 40 years, maybe you may be having a problem of diabetes or maybe a pressure or something like that. You can control the risk in the sense that you can take your food in a proper manner so that you're not affected by that type of a risk. That is, in the case of personal risk, it is possible. But in the case of most of the common risk, you cannot avoid the risk. Maybe you can reduce the degree of risk.
Okay, ma'am. Next question is from Achyutan Nedumar. Do you feel many risks could be reduced by anticipating history of certain risks and taking precautions?
Maybe to a certain extent, you can reduce the risk. reduce the risk in the sense by taking insurance or maybe by resorting to some other techniques, you can reduce the risk, reduce that the degree of the risk to a certain extent. And that is possible only, this is because of the historical law of experience, because whatever you have experienced in the past, from that only you learn for the future. So that definitely it is possible. You can reduce the risk, but in the proper way, you can, if you can plan it, then you can properly reduce.
Next question is from Veena. Pure risk, speculative risk should be included in enterprise risk.
Yes. See, pure risk, it is not included in enterprise risk, but it is said that pure risk is any risk which is normally applicable, which is applicable in any situation, and that is why pure risk is coming under enterprise risk, because enterprise risk, as the term indicates, it covers all types of risk which is affecting an enterprise, which is applicable to an organization as well.
Okay, ma'am, next question, we don't have a name. Will corona pandemic come under fundamental risk?
Yes, definitely. Because it is a fundamental risk in the sense, because it is affecting a large number of persons at the same time. And you cannot measure the loss, because the amount of loss, it will be different. Maybe it is a psychological issue which is created. It may not be, any loss cannot be quantified. So this loss can be treated as a fundamental risk.
Okay, next question is from Vidya. What do you mean by incorporation of a business firm in this?
Okay, incorporation of business firm is actually you are transferring the risk. It is a risk transfer mechanism where you are stating that your personal assets will not be liable. It's like an agreement. You are saying that your personal assets will not be liable if something happens in the case of a risk. Maybe if you are notifying the employees of the organization that this event will occur, so they are not taking any precautions. So the company can say that it is incorporation in the sense we have transferred it. Now we will not be undertaking or will not be undertaking the liability to pay off you, because we have already declared it in advance.
Okay, ma'am. Next question is from Anjana. She's asking, can you explain pooling technique?
Pooling technique is actually you're not insuring in a single company, but different insurance companies, they join together. That can be from the point of view of the insurance company. If it is from the point of view of the assured or the injured, they will be joining together in an organization. People, employees join together and they want to share the risk of loss. So they feel that one person is having a particular problem or a disease which is caused due to working in that particular company. Then we don't want to be affected, so we want to share the risk of loss, and that is what is called as pooling. Pooling is actually you're sharing the loss.
Okay, ma'am. Next is from Vidya again. What do you mean by wargaming in external risk?
I think I have not covered anything related to external risk. We have seen that external risk as a part of risk which is affecting the organization. That is what I have referred to.
Okay. Next question is from Abhintam. He is asking the classification software.
I think we have already explained the different types of risk in the first itself.
Next question is, can you explain loss forecasting and its technique?
Actually, this risk analysis or forecasting is coming under financial management. You might have seen the different techniques that are used in forecasting or finding out or assessing the risk. But that is not actually covered under risk management, because we are just seeing the basic concepts. There are different techniques, risk adjusted techniques, sensitivity analysis and all. You have already learned in financial management.
Okay, ma'am. Next is from Gayatri. She's asking, what are the difficulties in categorizing creation of risk.
You might have seen the different types of risk now. So you may not be feeling that there was a question. Previously there was a question regarding whether it is included under enterprise risk or not. This is actually the confusion that is being created, because the risks are mainly of objective or subjective nature, but there are different classifications of risk, and in the classification itself there are again variants of risk. So that is actually the difficulty in categorization of risk, because maybe you say that it is pure risk, but pure risk will be coming under enterprise risk. You will be classifying strategic risk. Maybe strategic risk will be coming under some other type of risk. This, you cannot watertight, there is no watertight classification of risk, but we are just seeing the different concepts of risk.
Okay, next question is by Sachin. He's asking, can you explain insurance coverage bit?
Okay, this is actually a method in which we have seen under one of the method of handling risk is insurance. So in insurance, one method is risk transfer. You're transferring the risk. So it can be in the form of like you're transferring the risk from one insurance company to another insurance company. So you're quoting for the highest payments or highest insurance who will be providing, and that you will be giving, or maybe that you will be engaging into the contract with that particular company. So that is actually insurance coverage bid. That means you're going in for a company who is ready to pay more for your coverage of risk.
Okay, ma'am. Next question is from Abhiyami. The question is incorporation of firm same as limited liability?
Same as limited? No, it cannot be said that it is same as limited liability, but it is actually having the essence of limited liability to a certain extent, because we are using it as a mechanism in order to handle the risk. So therefore, limited liability is used in different connotations in different courses, but this is actually purely related to handling of risk.
Okay, next question is from Achyutan Nirmal. What do you feel about someone getting disturbed constantly thinking about the risk?
That is what we have seen as subjective risk. Because the state of mind of people, if you always feel that you'll be having a risk, then you will definitely have a risk. So the best thing is to have a positive mind, a positive attitude that nothing will happen. Anyway, that you can be very much sure of, provided all conditions are favorable. It is always good to think positively.
Definitely not. Next question is from Daksha. What do you mean by non-insurance transfer?
We have already explained non-insurance transfer means we are not making use of insurance mechanism or something like that, but we are going in for some other processes where we are transferring the risk. So we are not resorting to just purely transferring the risk from the person to the insurance company, but we are using some other technique. That is what is called as non-insurance transfer.
Okay, ma'am. Next question is from Bali. How active retention can be done?
Hope you have seen the slides before itself. In the slide itself, I have already explained what is active retention. You might have listened to it. Active retention is actually you are aware of the risk, but you want to reserve the risk so that you want to save the money. Now you are not paying the money for insurance, but you want to save it for the future. That means now you are not keeping aside amount for insurance, but you will be needing it whenever it occurs.
Okay, next question is from Anju. Risk sharing is one of the method of handling risk. Reciprocal insurance come under risk sharing. How does this reciprocal insurance work for sharing this?
Okay, reciprocal risk in the sense you are sharing, instead of what do you call it, taking all the risk on one by one person itself, it is better to have a, it is applicable in the case of a group insurance policy. Okay, you are having a what do you call as insurance in large numbers, where you can share the risk in a very profitable manner. So that is the case.
Next question is from Aishwarya. Can you say that systematic risk and fundamental risk are the same?
Systematic risk is actually it covers the risk where you are not able to control it, and it can be market risk, it can be any other type of risk. So you cannot say that it is purely fundamental risk, because fundamental risk can be any type of risk which can be affecting the entire economy as such. It may be one part of the fundamental risk can be market related factors, because I have already said that fundamental risk can be caused by a natural phenomenon, it can be caused by a political phenomenon or a social phenomenon. You cannot say that it is purely because of market. It is not purely systematic risk. It can be some other factors.
Okay, ma'am. Next question is from Pradeep. He's asking whether the credit risk management system improved in banks after 2020.
Here we are actually seeing the basic concepts in this. We are not concerned about risk management in banks. We are only concerned about risk and its different categories, because so that is only there in the present model.
Next question, we don't have a name. It is pure risk and nature of opportunity.
Almost all the risks are objective. Some of the risk which is affecting only because of the which is affecting a particular individual can be treated as a subjective risk. So pure risk, mostly in most cases it is objective.
Next question is from Manoj. What are the major precautions for managing risk?
I think we have already seen the different ways in which you will have to handle this. How you can handle the risk, the different techniques we have already seen, in the form of avoidance, in the form of retention, in the form of control, in the form of insurance, in the form of non-insurance transfer. And in the case of persons, the precautions that persons normally take is they take insurance.
Sachin is asking how probability analysis helps in loss forecasting.
Okay. Probability analysis, that is what we have seen in the case of law of large numbers. In the case of law of large numbers, there are situations where you can predict, it is actually a part of probability analysis where you can say that on this many cases, what is actually the probability of this? If this many people are residing in that particular area, what is actually the probability? So this is actually a mathematical technique that is used, especially in research methodology, but this is being mentioned as a method in research.
What are the causes of foreign exchange risk?
Foreign exchange risk, you might have learned in the previous semester, international finance. And there you have a separate module for, especially for finding about foreign exchange calculation, management and risk and all. But I'll explain, foreign exchange risk is actually affecting a country as a whole. In a sense, the payment that the country will have to pay in order to get a sufficient foreign currency for any transaction can create, and that is actually the impact of foreign exchange risk.
Okay, Pradeep has also asked, what is the difference in methodology between risk identification and risk analysis?
Okay, risk identification, I think we have seen it yesterday. Yesterday we have seen risk management. In risk management, we have seen risk identification and risk analysis. Risk identification is actually you are trying to find out what is actually risk. what do you understand by, or what will be the risk that you will be facing? And risk analysis means what will be the degree of risk that you will be going to face. Identification is just finding out what. Analysis is actually concerned about how much.
What is credit risk? Is credit risk a type of financial risk?
Credit risk. Credit risk is credit risk can it comes under interest rate, because interest rate risk, commodity risk, currency risk, all these are coming under financial. So under financial risk, the credit risk can be considered under interest rate risk. You cannot have a separate classification of credit risk for financial risk. It comes under the interest rate risk.
Next question is from Shamina. She's asking, what is non-insurance risk?
Okay. Non-insurance risk transfer, we have already explained. It is actually concerned with, we are not engaging, or we are not involving insurance company, but we are doing it in the form of different forms where we are transferring the risk. We are not involving an insurance company here. You are just using some other methods which we have already explained.
What is stress testing?
Okay, actually it is not concerned with basic concepts in risk. Maybe it is a psychological one. Stress testing means you may be in a stress situation, a mental situation. You feel that something will happen. As you have asked, in your earlier question itself, you have asked whether people have different state of mind or something like that. So actually, you are testing the psychological position or maybe state of mind of a person, whether the person is always concerned about risk, that you can test, you can measure whether this person is being seriously affected by the concept of risk.
Acharan is asking, your talk was very informative. Can you recommend a book of literature where types of risks are available for reference, since I'm not an expert of risk and risk management?
Actually, this module, the first and second module, was recently introduced in the last revision of MCOM syllabus. So, you will not be finding a prescribed textbook for this. But there is a book recommended, which is given under books recommended list, which is written by George E. Rejda, R-E-J-D-A, George E. Rejda, which is by Pearson Education. That is Risk Management. The name of the book is Risk Management, which is written by George E. Rejda, which will be available in your library. You can refer to the book, or maybe online copies will be available. Actually, we had a copy in our library. It is purely, the two modules are entirely taken from that particular book.
Shamina is asking, can you please show the slide of non-insurance risk?
Okay.
Reshma is asking, what is meant by insurance terminology?
Insurance is actually a term which we normally indicate in order to cover a person from any type of a risk which may arise in the future. So insurance can be in the form of fire, it can be marine, it can be accident compensation. So different types of insurance are available in order to cover the risk.
Meenakshi is asking, what is loss control?
Loss control, we have already explained. I think we can go to the slide which I have explained in detail about loss control and the objectives of loss control also. It is concerned with loss prevention and loss reduction. Yesterday we have seen about frequency and severity of loss. Actually, it is concerned with controlling the frequency of the losses as well as the severity of the losses. That is concerned with loss control. Try to reduce the loss. That is one method of handling the risk.
Ma'am, Amla is asking, can you please show the first three slides?
The first one. Hope you have seen it. The second one. And this is the third one.
Okay, ma'am. We are going to our last question. Question is from Sachin. He is asking, what is forecasting based on loss distribution?
Actually, loss distribution is the term which is connected with risk management. Because whenever you expect or whenever you estimate about the risk in the future, how the risk is to be allocated, how the risk is to be controlled, whether you will have to retain it or whether it can be transferred for the next period, that is actually the decision regarding how you are distributing the losses, whether you are retaining it now or whether you are carrying it over to the next future year.
Thank you so much, ma'am, for your wonderful and informative session. And I thank all the participants for attending today's session and posted so many questions, which really shows how interested they were in this topic. Thank you so much once again. And you can keep checking the class schedules from the website skillpathkerala.org. We will get sessions relating to your topic on the coming day. Thank you so much, ma'am. Thanks, everybody. Good night.